A couple of months ago, I was home on a day off and I was flipping through the TV stations and I saw an old movie called Home Alone. And I know there's been four Home Alone movies, but number one is the best one in my opinion. And it's a story, if you don't know, and how many have never seen Home Alone? Anybody not seen Home Alone? Home Alone is a story of a family, of a big family, and mom and dad take their kids on vacation, and they happen to leave one kid back home. It's about 10 or 11 years of age. And so he's home, and he's has a charge card. He's charging up dad's credit card. He's having take-in and, you know, take-out food brought in, and he's doing all of these things. And then there are some robbers in the neighborhood, and they're coming through, and they see that that home is a big home, and he's left alone. There's nobody there. And so this little 10, 11-year-old boy begins to say, I'm going to outsmart these robbers. And he begins to set up funny things, the swinging paint buckets that hit the robbers in the head and Christmas ornaments on the floor that they stepped on and a generator with a heater, a welder so that when they touch the doorknob, they touch the doorknob and get burnt. It's funny, but it's sad that there are many people that are living just like that, home alone. And God dropped that into my heart about people that are home alone. And over the next, this week, and then the first 3 weeks of June, I'm going to deal with a very practical area. And if you have people that are going to get married, thinking of married, thinking of divorce, parents going to have children, we're going to speak on very, I'm going to be very plain vanilla. I'm going to say some things that may you say, well, that doesn't go in the place of church. Let me tell you, what I'm going to say today belongs in the house of God, because the sad truth is the church has become full of cultural Christians instead of Christians who are living the Word of God, and that the culture is impacting Christians instead of Christians impacting our culture. And Jesus says to come out of the world and to be separate. He tells us how to live. He says in 2 Peter, to add to your faith godliness. He tells us how to live and how we should be living as believers. And so I want to talk about that over the next few weeks, about people who are living all alone. We have people who are single and single again, people that have gone through divorce, people that are living alone and looking for a way of connecting with someone. There are singles who are so lonely that they're doing anything they can to find companionship in their life. We have a young teenagers who can't wait to get out of the house and say, I want to be on my own. And then when they turn 25, they want to move back in with mom and dad. But mom and dad has changed the locks on the door. Single moms and single dads who are living alone. There are couples who live in the same house, but they're basically home alone. There's no companionship. There's no friendship. There's no relationship. There are too many couples in the church who are talking divorce. There are children who are left alone most of the time because mom and dad aren't there. There are parents that are just waiting for an empty nest so that they can be alone and have some time for themselves. And the reality is, we need to understand what God's word says, that he doesn't want cultural Christians, but he wants Christians who are empowered by the power of the Holy Spirit and are saturated. See, we live in a culture today that has twisted the view of love and of marriage and of gender identity and of sex. We have gone into a world today that where used to be, where there would be an introduction that you would introduce to somebody. And then you would make a decision after that introduction if you want to pursue that. And then from introduction, it would become an acquaintance. And you would go out maybe for coffee, or you would begin to get to know something about that individual. And then if that acquaintance goes good, then you would want to develop a friendship with that individual. And then after that, then intimacy would come. But in our culture today, we've taken out parts 2 and 3, and all we go is from introduction to sex or to intimacy. And I want to tell you, that is not God's design for the child of God. God has a plan to do you good and not harm, to give you a hope and to give you a future. Because in our society today, we no longer value marriage. We live in a world that says marriage is nothing more than a piece of paper. And so we might as well just live together. We might as well just try it out. and see if we can put up with one another, and then we will do it down the road. Oh, there's open marriages, there's same-sex marriages, there's civil unions, there's living alone and having friends with benefits. And friends, we are living in a day when God is saying, I want my church to be my church. I want my people to be a holy people. I want my people to be different from the world. See what is going on in our world today. The census data release says that today there are over 31 million households of just one person compared to only 4 million in 2000. That tells me in the last 16 years that there has been that many more people who are home alone. For the first time in America, only 48% of homes have both a husband and a wife living in the same house. Singles are primarily women, who are around 17 million, and men are around 14 million, and most are between the ages of 35 and 64. I want to say right up front, it is better to be single and happy than to be in a wrong relationship and miserable outside of the will of God. There's nothing worse than being outside of the will of God. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles quickly this morning. I know I have less than 25 minutes. Proverbs 24, verses 3 through 6. Listen to what Solomon, the wisest man in the world, said. Use wisdom and understanding to establish your home. Let good sense fill the rooms with priceless treasures. Wisdom brings strength and knowledge and gives power. Battles are won by listening to advice and making a lot of plans. I know full well that there are going to be people that come to church on any given Sunday who are not going to listen to anything I say. I've resigned myself to that many years ago. There are people that just come. But God's word says use wisdom to build your house. Fill your house with wisdom. Fill your life with wisdom. Do it with understanding. Solomon is telling us to make sure the decisions that are impacting our lives are done with wisdom and understanding. He tells us to plan. He tells us to pray. And he tells us to prepare. How do we get ready for this life's most important decision? I want to give you a little quiz. It's not in your outline, so just listen. There's only two answers, true or false. 10 questions, just jot the answer down. Love at first sight occurs between some people, true or false? Don't answer out loud. Love at first sight occurs between some people. Question number two, it is easy to distinguish between love and infatuation, true or false? Number three, people who really love each other will not argue, true or false? Let me tell you, Em and I celebrate 35 years of marriage next week. Never had an argument in our life. Question number four. God selects one person for each of us to marry and will guide us to that one person, true or false? Number five, if a man or a woman genuinely love each other, then hardships and troubles will have little or no effect on their relationship, true or false? Number six, it is better to marry the wrong person than to remain single and to be alone, true or false? Question number seven, it is not harmful to have sex before marriage if a couple has a meaningful relationship, true or false? Number eight, if a couple is really in love, that will ensure that their love will last for their lifetime. True or false? Number nine, short engagements are the best, 6 months or less. True or false? Number 10, teenagers are more capable of genuine love than our older people. True or false? If you mark false on all those questions, then you understand the difference between love and what love is all about. Any question that you mark true to is wrong. It's amazing in America that it's tougher to get a driver's license than it is a marriage license. You got to go for classes for a driver's license. You got to get a permit. You got to have someone sit next to you on the, in, you know, skip mom or dad half the debt as you learn to drive. And then you have to go and take another test. And then eventually you get your license. And then you get a special license where you can't drive with anybody in the car. And there's all these requirements to get a driver's license. But isn't it amazing that you can go down to City Hall, you can get a license, and 2 minutes later, you can be married? We don't have any understanding of what the most important decision that we make outside of salvation is the person that we will spend our life with for the next 30, 40, 50 years. Friends, let me tell you, we need to get some understanding when it comes to what's going on in our situation. Can I have an amen? I remember when my son-in-law that we dedicated the baby last week, and Steve was in the army, and he was in Afghanistan, and they were having a long-distance relationship. That's the way to date. He's in Afghanistan and she's in Massachusetts. That is the way to go. So I really didn't know how deep this relationship was going. And so I'm in my office at the church, and my secretary comes and says, Steve Plum's here to see you. And I had no clue in a breadbasket what Steve wanted. So Steve comes into my office. It's in the middle of January. He's sweating bullets. I mean, sweat's coming off of him. And he sits down across my desk, and he says, can I marry your daughter? I said, hemmed and hawed. I didn't know what to say first. I said, no, you got to come back tomorrow. See, he made a mistake. He didn't have my wife there. Because I was not going to make a decision without talking to my wife. So that all night, he already had the ring. He already had the plan. He was bringing out my daughter that night. He had all these plans, and now the plans were thrown up because now we couldn't do it. And so the next day, he comes back into my office sweating again. I mean, the sweat's coming. What am I going to say? What am I going to say? And I gave him my blessing to marry my daughter. Friends, let me tell you, we take such a low view of that area of our life. And God is saying, I want you to raise the level of your relationship. So let me give you some things to consider before you commit to somebody. Commitment is not only marriage, but I believe it goes as back to dating, to engagement, to whatever it is. Let me give you some things that you need to examine if you are going to commit yourself. First of all, am I the right person? How many times we say, man, I'm looking for Mr. Right. Who is Mr. Right? You know, we judge that by looks, by how much money they have, how much education they have, what kind of car they drive, all those things. We look for Mrs. Wright, and we say, man, can they take care of me? Will they make me happy? Let me tell you, no one else can make you happy if you're a miserable person. Can I have an amen? It's unrealistic to think some guy, Mr. Wright's going to come along, and he's going to wrap his arms around you. He's going to take all your troubles away. Friends, marriage doesn't fail, but the people in the marriage fail. See, all marriage does is reveal or show off the people that are in the marriage. It just reveals what is down deep inside. Man, you get the best when you're dating. The moment you say, I do, and you get back from the honeymoon, you see the real McCoy. I remember my last two churches ago, there was a lady who was in her upper 60s who went for bypass surgery. And as the surgeon came out, I was with the family, and the surgeon came out and says she wants the pastor to come in, not her husband. Well, that was kind of strange. I thought, first of all, that she wants me to come in, not her husband. And so I said, okay, I'll go in and see what the situation is. And when she came in, she says, Pastor, would you go out? Don't let my husband in. We've been married for 40-something years, and my husband has never seen me without makeup on. So I can't let him see me in the way that I... Let me tell you, if you've been married for 45 years and you haven't seen your wife without makeup or your husband without makeup, then friends, something is wrong in that relationship. The reality is marriage reveals the real McCoy. It reveals who we really are. And I got to be the right person and stop looking for the right person. Tony Campolo said this, many people marry because they think that marriage will overcome the inadequacies of their own personality, being complete persons through the complementary qualities of their mate. No other person can satisfy the emptiness and the longing of your heart. No guy, no woman, no one else can satisfy you but Jesus Christ. And if you're not satisfied in yourself, then nobody else can satisfy you. If you're not happy yourself, nobody else can make you happy. So I need to look within myself and ask the question, am I the right person? The second question I need to ask is I need to examine the family of the person that you're thinking of committing to. Let me tell you marry the family. The good, the bad, and the ugly. And so, you know, it's amazing. We do background checks for a lot of things. If you get in a job, you got to do a background check. If you're going to work with children and youth here in the church, you're going to have to do a background check because we want to check out what you're doing. How many of us go into marriage and we never do a background check? I'm not talking about the Social Security number and getting all that on your husband's or your wife's family, but we need to examine what their family is like. There was a guy that wanted to ask his girlfriend to marry him. And he knew that he would have to go and ask her father for her hand in marriage. The father was a cranky, grouchy, miserable man. And the young man in fear, trembling, went to the father, like, this isn't me, to ask for his daughter's hand in marriage. And the future father-in-law said, it looks like you wanted me as your father-in-law. Is that right? Boy, trembling in fear, said, no, but it's the only way I can get your daughter. And the reality is we need to look at some things. I remember when I was dating and I went to Emma's family, and Emma's family was a lot different than my family. How many know families are different? You know, my family is nuts. My family is loud. My family is expressive. My family, you know, we fight. We wrestle. We do all those things. Emma's family was more reserved. And, you know, I would go and they may not talk to me for 3 days. So it's just different family. And so when Emma came to my family and we're all playing game and all this kind of commotion, she would sit there. My godly grandfather, who was a pastor during the Great Depression, said, Ronnie, he called me off the side, I don't think she's going to make it in ministry because she's a mute. She doesn't talk. So you don't know the miracle that took place last week when she got up here to preach. My grandfather was in heaven. Thank God, 34 years, and she got a voice. But the reality is we marry the family. We come out of different situations. We need to examine the family. Look at something. How was their childhood happiness? Was the home life fun? Was there joy? Was there happiness? How about the happiness of the parents? Were mom and dad happy together? Did they have PDA? That's public display of affection. When was the last time your children saw you kiss your wife or hold the hand of your husband? When was the last time they heard the words, I love you, I love you, I love you? Friends, happiness of the parents. What is the family life like? Are they loving towards one another? Do they respect each other? Oh, how about what kind of boundaries and discipline is there in the family? Man, there are some families that have boundaries. No one comes over. Other families, they come in like everybody loves Raymond with Frank and Marie. I mean, they just come over morning, noon, and night. I mean, there are some families that are like that. You need to know the family that you are thinking of committing to. Can I have an amen? Here's a big one. You better do a background check on the issues of alcohol and drug abuse, because that's a big deal today. We say, he's a Christian or she's a Christian. The reality is we need to do a background check. Is there physical or sexual abuse? Friends, another thing you need to ask yourself is, am I emotionally prepared? Not only am I the family background, but am I emotionally prepared for marriage? Are you ready for marriage? You know, some boys were talking about marriage in a little Sunday school class, and one 10-year-old boy said, I don't know who I'll marry, but I'll tell you one thing. She'll have to sign some sort of paper that says that she takes out the garbage and I get to watch whatever TV shows I want. That's funny when it's 10. Not when they're 40 or 50. It's funny, but when reality is marriage is not for selfish people. It's not the attitude of what can I get out of marriage? How do you know if you're emotionally ready for marriage? Here's a couple, look in your outline. There is no rush to get married. Well, if you really love me, you'll let me touch you. Oh, we got to do it right away. You know, I'm 22. I'm getting old. Do you really love me? You know, I test drive a car. Can I test drive you? Oh, if you love me. Friends, I don't see that in the Word of God. I want you to turn me to Genesis chapter 29. Let me tell you, we need to be emotionally prepared for marriage. Genesis 29, verse 15. We know the story of Jacob, but here's the story of Jacob. Then Laban, his father-in-law, future father-in-law, said, because you are my relative, you should therefore serve me for nothing. Tell me, what should your wages be? Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah's eyes were delicate, but Rachel was beautiful of form and appearance. So Rachel is a 10. Leah is something less than a 10. Jacob saw Rachel. He was hot for her. He wanted her. He wanted to know her. He wanted a relationship with her. The next verse. Now Jacob loved Rachel, so he said, I will serve you what? Serve you what? 7 minutes. Then we're going to get together. No. I'm going to work for you for 7 years. 7 years is a long time. Can you imagine how she must have changed over 7 years? I mean, 7 years, but he was willing to work for her. Some of us aren't willing to work for our marriages after we've been married for 2 years. I will serve you 7 years for Rachel, your younger daughter. And Laban said, it is better that I give her to you than I should give her to another man. Stay with me. So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel. And here, look in these next words. And they seemed only a few days to him because of the love he had for her. Man, do you have love for your wife that way? Man, I work for her. I love her. I love her. It doesn't matter. I can't have her now. But 7 years, in 7 years, she's going to be all mine. Then the next verse. Then Jacob said to Laban, give me my wife, for my days are fulfilled, that I may go into her. He's saying, I've waited 7 long years. I'm a red-blooded young man. I want to get it going. I want my wife. I want to get it. I want to have it. I want to do it now. I mean, he waited 7 long years. And Laban gathered together all the men of the place and made a feast. Now it came to pass in the evening that he took Leah, his daughter, and brought her to Jacob. Man, they didn't have electricity back then. It must have been dark in the tent that night. That's all I know. He takes the less than the 10 and brings her in. He's been waiting for Rachel. And all of a sudden, Leah comes in. Let's go on in the story. And Leah's daughter, and brought her to Jacob, and he went into her. And Laban gave his maid Zilpha to his daughter Leah as a maid. So it came to pass in the morning, man, when the lights came on, the sun came up, that behold, it was Leah. And he said to Laban, what is this you have done to me? Was it not for Rachel that I served you? Why then have you deceived me? And Laban said, it must not be done so in our country to give the younger before the firstborn. Fulfill her week, and we will give you this one. He didn't even call his other daughter Rachel. He said, and I'll give you this one. Also for the service which you will serve with me, still another 7 years. And then Jacob did so and fulfilled her week, and he gave him his daughter Rachel as his wife also. Can you imagine 14 years? Some of us won't go out of our way 14 minutes to work on our relationships. We've allowed the world to impact. We've allowed the world, to the culture, to come against us. Friends, that's what commitment, that's what love is. Warning, you need to slow down in your relationship. You need to wait. You need to make sure of the godliness and the character and the integrity of the one you're going to commit your life to. Make sure that they are really a Christian and not in name only. Give it some time. Wait, wait, wait until God opens the door. Number two, your selfishness needs to be under control. See, marriage is not, commitment is not for children. It is for those who are mature. It says in 1 Corinthians 13:11, when I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man, I put all my ways of a child behind me. So start praying, God, help me, Lord, to be mature. Help me to grow up. Help me, Lord, to understand the responsibility that you have. Oh, here's another one. Another sign of being emotionally ready for marriage is that love is based on commitment and not on feelings and emotions. I know B.J. Thomas wrote a song, Hooked on a Feeling. And there's too many Christians who are hooked on feelings. They're hooked on feelings spiritually, that I only serve God when the feelings are there. Let me tell you, God is not looking to further our feelings. He is looking for commitment out of our lives. He's looking for those who will trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Let me tell you, marriage will not always, commitment will not always be emotional high. 35 years of marriage. Oh, well, I don't feel in love. Let me tell you, you don't live by feelings. You live by a commitment that you made to God Almighty. Until death do us part. For better, for worse, for richer or poorer, in sickness and in health, until death do us part. Feelings come and go, but commitment stays through the difficult time. Oh, here's another one. I need to ask, am I financially prepared for marriage? Look what it says in 1 Timothy 5:8. If anyone does not provide for his family, and especially his immediate family, he is denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Someone said it this way, don't marry for money. You can borrow it a lot cheaper. Now, there's some money mistakes that Christians make as well, because we're bought into the cultural society values. But God's word talks more about our money than it does about heaven or hell. But yeah, we want, oh, pastor, preach more about hell. Let me preach God's word. Friends, God's word tells us don't get into debt. Getting awful quiet in here. It says if you're going to get committed to someone, the borrower, Proverbs 22:7, the borrower is servant to the lender. More marriages struggle over money issues. Debt will strangle a relationship. It will struggle a family. Romans 13:8 says, owe no man anything except to love. Oh, here's another thing, not being a good steward of our finances, not taking care of the things that God has given to us, using it poorly. It says in Proverbs chapter 24, I passed by the field of the sluggard and by the vineyard of the man lacking sense, and behold, it was completely overgrown with thistles. Its service was covered with nettles, and its stone wall was broken down. When I saw, I reflected upon it. I looked and received instruction. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, then your poverty will come as a robber and you will want an armed man. The reality is God is saying, I want you to be faithful what I've given to you. If I can't be faithful with the little, then God's not going to give me more. Can I have an amen? He says, don't you love money and the things of the world? We talked about that earlier, that godliness with contentment is great gain. That, friends, we need to love one another. We need to love our mate. It's not money. You can't buy love. You can't buy those things. Possessions will never make you love someone. Love comes from a heart and a relationship that is committed to the other one. And lastly, you got to trust God with your money. Willing to obey God in the area of your money. The sad truth is that less than 10% of Christians across America believe in tithing. We wonder why there's not a blessing upon the lives and upon our marriages. Look what Malachi chapter 3 says. Friends, this is God's word. You can take it or leave it. But I remember when I was a young 12, 13-year-old boy, when I had my first job as a paper boy, I remember when I get home, my mom and dad would sit me down. And in those days, they gave you cash. And so they would count out the cash. And if I made $30, $3 went into an envelope to give in tithes. Let me tell you, you need to teach your children at an early age to give God what belongs to God. Because if you can't tithe on $20, you're not going to tithe on $200. And you're not going to tithe on $2,000. But when you understand that God is the owner of all, and that God is my supplier, and God is my provider, then I can give everything that belongs to him. Why? For Malachi chapter 3 verse 6 says, "For I am the Lord, I do not change." I'm so glad the Lord is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That the same God that provided manna for the children of Israel in the wilderness is the same God that can provide for his children today in the wilderness called America. I'm so glad that the Lord is the same yesterday, today, and forever. It says, "Therefore you are not consumed, O sons of Jacob, yet from the days of your fathers you have gone away from my commands and have not kept them." He's saying you no longer obey me. And friends, that's what's happening with cultural Christianity. He says, "You return to me and I will return to you, says the Lord of hosts." But you said, "In what way shall we return?" He could have said, "Well, you need to fast, you need to pray, you need to go to church, you need to be involved in ministry." But no, what did he say? Verse 8, "Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. You are cursed with the curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it." The reality is 31 million Americans are out of work and have given up looking for a job. And let me tell you, Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton is not going to fix the situation in America. God is going to serve. My son-in-law, who has been struggling taking care of his family, never went to college. He had a job, and over the last couple of weeks, he's been looking at interviewing with another company. He found, the day after the dedication, he got a call from the company that they want to take him. They want to hire him. They gave him $25,000 more than the last company, and they gave him full health insurance for his entire family. Let me tell you, when you put God first and God, you get involved in God's finances, God will get involved in your finances. I don't need a trust in the lottery. I don't need a trust in bingo. I don't need a trust in the world to take care of me. I have a good, good father that will take care of me when I trust God with my finances. Oh, quickly, I know I only have 5 minutes. Are you morally prepared for marriage? Are you morally prepared? We live in a world that is so immoral. If you're going to commit yourself to someone, you need to be morally committed. Morally, are you able to commit to that person? Marriage is a commitment to be true to this person for the rest of your life. I want to say something. In America culture, we're like two-way tape when it comes to our sexual lives. We think it's no big deal if I sleep around. Oh, it's no big deal if I cheat on my husband or my wife. You know what happens with two-way tape? The more you use it and unuse it, the less sticky it gets. You know why the average marriage lasts less than 7 years in America? It's because we have so many loose partners in our life. And we wonder why it doesn't stick. Well, because we have pornography and we look at that. We look at people, hookers. We look at stepping out. We're living together. And we think, well, it's no big deal. Let me tell you, God is saying, I'm looking for a church without spot and without wrinkle. I love you in the name of Jesus. But the reality is, if you're sexually immoral, then God cannot bless a mess. But that God says, if you will confess your sin and repent, then I will forgive you and I will take care of you. If you have not been morally pure before marriage, then the tendency is that you will not change after marriage, because immorality does not only apply to single people, but it applies to married people who are in God's house, husbands and wives that are morally impure. Are you faithful? Married people need to realize that you're sexually tempted as well. Why are there so many couples that are committed committing adultery on their maids is because we're no longer moral. We're no longer biblically centered. We're no longer centered on the Word of God. And Christians should be the most moral people, not the most legalistic people. Legalistic is, man, I dressed the part, I looked the part, I can't wear this, I can't wear. Legalism's from the outside. But when you have Jesus living on the inside, let me tell you, you are going to be a moral person. See, I must daily commit myself to biblical perspective of morality. Friends, not the culture society perspective, not the world's perspective, but what is God's perspective? God's perspective is very clearly stated in the Word of God, and I say it in the authority of God's word, that fornication or sex before marriage, one night stands, going to the bar, picking up somebody and sleeping around, it's not okay. It is sin in the eyes of the Lord Jesus Christ. Adultery, if you are married and you're having sex with anyone else than your partner, then it is sin. Pornography is a sin. Lusting after another person is sin. Jesus clearly said it in Matthew chapter 5. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I tell you that anyone who looks on a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in her heart. Everything in the world is okay. It doesn't matter what we do. If it's right in our own eyes, we can do it. That may be cultural, but it's not biblical today. Newsweek magazine did an article on sex in our country. Deborah Conning was giving a career advice to seventh grade girls on National Day of Taking Your Daughter to Work Day. This was her advice to that class. Sleep around all you want, just don't get married. You look at the TV and the movies that we're watching. You look at what our kids are growing up under today. There is no sense of morality. You look at the Game of Thrones and Modern Family and Scandal and The Good Wife and Mad Men and 2 1/2 Men and Sex in the City. And the idea is that nothing matters. You can do whatever you want. Friends, I want you to turn me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And I'm bringing it to an end. Oh, I'm already late. Let me just give this. It's 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 1. Finally then, brothers, we urge you and exhort in the Lord Jesus that you should not abound, that you should abound more and more, just as you receive from us how you ought to walk and please God. Friends, we need to please God in all that we do. Can I have an amen? For you know what commandments we have gave you through the Lord Jesus. For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you should abstain from sexual immorality, that each of you should know how to possess his own vessel. He said, well, your pastor, you don't know about that girl, that she came on to me and I just had to fall. I had to give in. No, the reality is I'm responsible for me. And if I'm saturated, I put boundaries around my life. The reality is I'll never counsel a woman in my office by myself unless my wife's in the next office. I'll never give a woman a ride home in my car. No pastor can take a woman home in their car by themselves. Well, that's kind of mean, pastor. No, I'm protecting the dignity. I'm protecting the minister of God. He says, I got to keep this vessel, my own vessel, in sanctification and honor. Not in passion of lust like the Gentiles who do not know God. That no one should take advantage of and defraud his brother in this matter. Because the Lord is the avenger of all such, as we also forewarned you and testified. For God did not call us to uncleanness, but in holiness. Therefore, he who rejects this does not reject men. You can reject everything I've said today. You're not rejecting me, but you're rejecting God, who has given us his Holy Spirit. Oh, to stay morally pure, don't let your children, if you are parents here, let me write this down. The earlier your children date, the more likely they are to be sexually active before 18. These are the facts. If your child starts dating at the age of 12, 91% of them will have sex before 18. If they date at age 13, 56%. At age 14, 53%. At age 15, 40%. At age 16, 20%. I'm asking mom and dad, protect your children morally. Stand in the gap for them. Live the life before them. But we also must be spiritually prepared for marriage. I want to say this in closing this morning, that if I'm not spiritually protected, friends, God's word says that what good, don't be bound together with unbelievers. For what partnership have righteousness and law? Let me tell you, as ICC, our marriage policy, our wedding policy, no pastor can marry an unbeliever to a believer. Say, Pastor, that's not fair. No, the reality is I got to give an account for everything I do. And if it's saving you, protecting you, then we need to do that. This is the only biblical command that God gives in selecting of a marriage partner. So I close. I'm going to ask us to stand all over this place. And I want to close with encouragement today.